As someone who grew up in the failed state that is the United Kingdom, and as someone who has often had what most people would describe as too much of an interest in virtual worlds and maps and such, it should absolutely come as no surprise to you that I have a bit of a thing for when my country appears in video games. Which is a shame, because for the most part the appearances are cameo level, in terrible games, or so long ago that they've been swallowed and forgotten by the cultural zeitgeist. But if you are willing to stick with me, I'm going to go over a few of them and see if they are worth the space that they take up in my brain. Space that I could use for more important stuff, like my PIN numbers or the faces of people I love. Oh, and before we get started, this isn't going to be a completely exhaustive list, but I have to say, before we get started, so I don't get a comment from someone called, like, Based Bastard 23 calling me a slur because I didn't mention 1990s Carlos Sainz World Rally Championship for the ZX Spectrum. I may be old, but I'm not that old. So I've tried to focus on games that I've heard of or actually at least played a little and are remembered by people. So don't at me, you motherfucker. So I became a sentient creature around the middle of the 1990s, which isn't something I would advise for most people to try, but it meant that I was coherent enough to play the SNES and the Mega Drive generation, but I don't really have any memories of it. And in a statement that is sure to anger folk, I don't really feel like I'm missing out on much. But I have a strong dislike for the platformer genre, which we'll get into another time because we ain't got time for that. But for me, the early days of video games was the first 3D generation, you know, your Sega Saturns, your Sony PlayStations, your Nintendo 64s, that sort of era. That's where I came onto the scene, and that is the era that has been hard-coded into my childhood nostalgia factory.
What are you playing?
Tomb Raider 3.
She's drowning.
Yeah.
Is that the point of the game?
Depends what mood you're in, really.
And who from this generation doesn't remember playing Tomb Raider? A lot of the missions were PlayStation 1 era difficult, so for a lot of us younger folk or people who were kids when they were playing this for the first time, we mainly remember the bonus level where you got to run around her mansion and fuck with the butler. Because again, most of us struggled to get past the first couple of levels in those games. I think I remember fighting a tiger at one point. It was ridiculous. I'd argue for a lot of people that this would have been their first UK located video game. Again, if I believe the metrics for my channel, most of you are zoomers, but basically in the 1990s we had to make our own objectives in video games, like tricking an old man into getting trapped in a giant walk-in freezer. But it wasn't just Lara Croft's posho home county's pad, there was other places in the UK that featured. We also got an incredibly blocky version of the City of London in Tomb Raider 3. It had Thames Wharf, which was kind of set around St. Paul's and not Canary's Wharf, as some misremember. The abandoned tube station at Oldwich, which I could bore you for hours about. Lud's Gate, a level based around the Natural History Museum, which had far, far too much fucking swimming, if I recall correctly. And a level set in some nondescript office block in the city, presumably by, like, Old Street or somewhere. London also turned up in some of the PS2 era Tomb Raiders, but let's be real, ain't nobody cared about PS2 era Tomb Raiders. Come on, what are you talking about? What do you want me to say? I mean, it's a War of the Worlds game on PS1, based on the 1970s musical by Jeff Wayne. It's... no one asked for this, but in the late 90s we got a bunch of very weird IP property tie-in games that were just bad. shall we say, bad. The gameplay for this one was a vehicle combat game, which was, of course, the style at the time, with your Twisted Metal and Vigilante 8, which I'll get to you, Vigilante 8. You're not in this video, but I'm gonna get to you. And although the CD-based nature of the PlayStation 1 allowed the soundtrack for War of the Worlds to be pretty crisp, it got a seemingly obligatory late 90s house remac. The CD-based nature of the PlayStation 1 allowed the soundtrack to be pretty crisp, and it got a seemingly obligatory late 90s house remix. Seriously, if you've ever wanted to hear a trip-hop version of the Red Weed song, look it up. But if you actually played this back then, hats off to you. But I think the only exposure to it for me was through the PlayStation Magazine demo disc and seeing copies and copies of it slowly accumulating at my local games exchange, which was a shop that was kind of like pre-CEX. I'm getting into it. Never mind. This game also deserves a mention for being the first on the list to include Glasgow, former stabbing capital of Europe, and my adopted home. If you think England isn't in many games, you should see how short the list is for Scottish-based games, but there'll be more up later, so you can stick a pin in that, alright?
Oi!
What?
I thought you said he was a getaway driver. What the fuck can he get away from, eh?
Don't worry about Tyrone. He can move when he has to.
Oh man, I don't know about anyone else, but the first driver game holds a special place in my heart. It was one of the first 3D driving games I played with a somewhat open world. Okay, the missions were pretty linear, as well as being ball-breakingly hard. I mean, how many people couldn't get past that driving test in the car park that was the game's first level? I've never seen a game just bounce people off people wanting to play it so hard as that level. But it had that good 70s style retro car chases with big blocky cars and drifting floaty controls that make you pay for any errors. You got to see hubcaps spinning off and flying down the road. It captured the aesthetic of your late 60s, early 70s American car chases. But I can hear you all already thinking, Driver wasn't set in the UK, and I know, right, okay? The four cities in the first Driver were Miami, San Francisco, Los Angeles, and New York. I know this, but, the real heads amongst you may know that Newcastle was actually in the first game as well, as the developers, Reflections Interactive, were based in Newcastle, and so it was included as an unlockable extra on the PC, or with a cheat code on PS1. But it basically consists of the small area around the Tyne Bridge and some of the Quayside. There is an alternate timeline where we got a driver game where instead of riffing on American car chases from the 1970s, they focused on UK car chases from the 1970s. And we got games like The Professionals, but on the PS2. There's a fucking hauntology for you. This is the big one. The first Grand Theft Auto was one of the first games I can remember, or at least one of the first games that seared itself into my brain and is still rememberable to this day. My older brother sold it to me as a 7-year-old, as Matchbox Cars the game, and I spent hours just driving around those top-down cities as a kid. I think the fart and burp button got far more use for me than the weapons did, but I will gush about the first GTA another time, because in 1999 Rockstar snuck out a little expansion pack, or what the kids these days would just call DLC, which was GTA London 1969. Riding the 60s revival movement that was in the late 1990s, look at Austin Powers for another example of this, they had a brand new map, all the cars were redone to be era appropriate, and even new radio stations. Was there anything new in this game? I mean, no, it was still the basic GTA 1 gameplay, but you could drive around a very square version of London, and if you go deeper into the madness, they released an expansion to the expansion pack, London 1961, which even included a multiplayer map based on Manchester, which I can imagine was enjoyed by like the three people that played it. Still, GTA London does have the usual gold standard of GTA soundtracks, with a fantastic radio selection of reggae, jazz, and 60s pop parodies. I would say it's worth trying out now, but Rockstar seems determined to not allow people to play any of the Grand Theft Autos before 3 at this point. So good luck finding a copy and getting it running on modern hardware. As we head into the second generation of 3D, London starts to become featured more and more as the English location in video games, especially alongside a pissy grey filter and inevitable bad rain effects. I never got a chance to play the early Midtown Madness games, a somewhat open world racer from the early 2000s, mainly due to it being a PC exclusive game, and young Dave having a home computer from the late 1980s that could basically just about play Pong. I did play some of Midtown Madness 3 on one of those 3 trial consoles you used to get in game shops. Remember the 90s kids? God, I won't start on that tangent, but I have it, believe me. And it seemed quite fun. But Midtown Madness 2 featured San Francisco, boring, and a weird condensed version of London, something that is going to become a recurring theme. Holborn is completely absent, most boroughs are reduced to single streets, it had all the vehicles you can buy in any good novelty London shop, you know, black cabs, double-decker buses, Mini Coopers, that sort of thing. I would complain, but to be honest, it's quite good to have some lazy stereotyping towards the English for a change. I welcome it, actually. We deserve it. We're pigs. The originator of the cool points racing game, Project Gotham Racing, is a series that has been dormant for frankly too long, with its last game coming out in the Xbox 360 days, I think, with Project Gotham Racing 4. The first game, though, was on the original Xbox and was kinda a spiritual successor to the Metropolis Street Racer, which came out the year before on the Dreamcast. Kinda like Soul Edge and Soul Calibur games if you're a fighting game person. They had the initial game on the Dreamcast that wasn't so successful, and then they basically reimagined it for a better console. Sorry, Dreamcast, but you died. Both games' interpretation of London consisted of a bit of central London around Trafalgar Square, the Houses of Parliament and Buckingham Palace, you know, all the bog standard touristy places. These games also had radio stations with actual era-appropriate music and adverts, so you can go online and listen to the R&B station or the drum and bass station, and it actually has adverts from like the early 2000s and stuff, real adverts like Tango and things like that, so it's an interesting little time capsule if nothing else. But R.I.P. Project Gotham Racing. Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2. Not 2, it's 4. Another game, another central London location based around Trafalgar Square. It's almost as if the only place non-UK folk know about. And a bit of South Bank due to it being a genuine real-life skating spot, which, respect, Tony Hawk's, respect. Or at least it was before the corporatisation of central London. I think now if you skateboard on the South Bank, you will get shot. So don't attempt that. It's fine, this game. It looks like a UK skin of an old Tony Hawk map, and it has some truly, truly appalling British accents. So you may want to avoid it for that alone.
I've been shot. I don't fucking believe this. Could everyone stop getting shot?
Okay, so this is one of the big tentpole games that inspired this list in video, really. For those of you that don't remember it, The Getaway was an attempt to do a kind of immersive GTA-style drivey shooty game set in London in the early 2000s and attempting to ride the kind of Guy Ritchie Cockney gangster money train. The first game was made by Team Soho, who quickly got folded into Team London by Sony, and they went on to make the sequel Black Monday in 2004. After the release of Black Monday, however, they were sent into the Sony first party novelty games gulag, and have been making SingStar and iToy games for the last 20 years now. There was also a PSP spin-off based around small gang wars in London called Gangs of London. You know that really big high production Sky TV show called Gangs of London? that's officially based on the PSP spin-off of Getaway, a truly insane deep cut that anyone remembers that, let alone wants to make a TV show out of it. Anyway, The Getaway was an impressive technical feat at the time. I remember being absolutely blown away by it when it came out. It contained 16 square miles of London, which sounds like a lot, but it really is only the central London, or Zone 1 for those that know the tube network. And even then, a lot of the side streets and alleyways were left out. You can see that the developer's studio in Soho is quite well done, the small streets and alleyways of Soho showing up exactly as they are in the game. But as you head out from that central point in Soho, things become more and more generic. Still, it was an utter thrill to play a video game where you can drive around in a Rover 3500 before having a shootout in front of a WH Smith's. How they got away with the licensed things in this game, I do not know. A testament to how accurate they got this map right is that I have been able to navigate myself around central London with only knowledge of it from this game. Now, admittedly, other than the novelty of it being Grand Theft England, the game really wasn't that good. The story was the most generic land and geezers plot you can imagine, and due to the game's attempt at realism, the shooting and damage mechanics were... Janky jank. The sequel, Black Monday, ironed out a lot of the kinks in the shooting and other mechanics, but not nearly enough people gave it a chance, and the series kind of fizzled out after the PSP Games of London entry. There was a swanky fancy tech demo trailer for a PS3 Getaway game, but we never got to see it, and that's another case of tests. What happened, guys? Why couldn't we get a PS3 Getaway? That's all we wanted. That's all we wanted. You broke my heart.
Names are for friends, so I don't need one.
Hitman Contracts came out in 2004, and it's often overlooked in all the Hitman games, given it was a kind of semi-remake of the first game, because the mechanics and everything of the first game has not aged well. It takes place in a post-Blood Money mission, the game that came out after it, where that goes wrong and Agent 47 is bleeding out and hallucinating his previous hits. It's no surprise that this game is weird, fragmented, moody, suspenseful, and all those big wanky words that reviewers like to use. From the opening mission in a Romanian fetish night in a slaughterhouse to its last mission, which is basically just the end of Leon the Professional but in France, there are some real highlights in Contracts for those willing to dig into it, and I always will recommend this over Absolution. I'll even say this is better than Hitman 2. Fight me. Also, the soundtrack by Jesper Kidd, full of absolute certified bangers. One of the highlights of the game, however, is Beldingford Manor, a map set in the remote English country estate where our lord is hunting the deadliest of prey, man. It's a really good level that showcases Hitman's best quality, giving you various methods to solve the puzzle, that is, murdering a lord and his son without having every farmhand murder you for it. We were never really given a solid location for Beldingford Manor, but I mean, come on, it sounds Tory as shit. So I'm going to say it's like the house next door to Lara Croft's pad in like the home county, Surrey or whatever. ...2007 wasn't a good time for Sony PlayStation. The PlayStation 3 had just come out to a lot of ridicule for its looks, its launch games, its price, and a bunch of other stuff. Xbox was well on its way to having its goal of a 360 in every home, and part of that push making that happen was the Halo games. And what did Sony have in retaliation? Well, there was Killzone. That had made its underwhelming debut on PS2, and we wouldn't see a sequel to the Killzone franchise until 2009. Haze? Does anyone remember Haze? The so-called Halo killer by the Time Splitters lads? A game so bad it killed their studio and relegated one of the best shooters of all time to the graveyard? No. Yeah, Sony weren't doing great. However, they had one more hope in the Resistance series. Yeah, most of you remember it. Know where I'm going with this one. Resistance was a terrible FPS set in an alternate 1950s where aliens have invaded Earth in the Soviet Union and now are pushing the Allied forces out of Europe and into England. So the entire game is jumping across the UK fighting aliens. Sounds like a recipe for a good time, right? Nah, this turd needed more time in the oven, but it's one of the only games to feature my previous haunt, Somerset, which was accurately depicted as a blocky, low-resolution shithole with things that want to tear your face off in every other field. It also featured Bristol, which is kind of like Liverpool but with better accents, and a level set in Manchester Cathedral that was enough to get some religious folk interested in the game, more importantly, interested in getting the game cancelled. An hour after the first game, however, it was relocated to America and the whole UK-based novelty was lost. They made two more and I would say pass on those ones. Real pass.
One place that hasn't been corrupted by capitalism. Space!
So I'm going to push the boat out on this one and say that Command & Conquer Red Alert 3 is actually the best Red Alert game. And if you disagree with me, you can meet me outside the Clyde Bank Asda for a shirtless fight about it. But seriously, you've got an evolution of the gameplay that made Red Alert 2 so good. You've got all of the celebs having fun in their live action videos. You've got Tim Curry's Russian premiere, well known of course. But you've also got J.K. Simmons as an android US president. You've got Jonathan Pryce as the British Prime Minister. Anyway, there's like one level where you have to invade Brighton Beach. It's good.
Dear Esther, I sometimes feel as if I've given birth to this island.
Walking simulators are good, actually, and this is arguably the first one, and the game that created the term, birthed the genre, whatever wanky descriptions you want to use for this type of game. Dear Esther started out as a Half-Life 2 mod, and it ended up getting its own standalone release due to it being good, actually. Which is a vast difference from most of Half-Life 2's spin-off. I'm talking about you, Gary's mod. Yeah, go fuck yourself. Dear Esther is a game about going to a remote Hebridean island to contemplate a life lived. It's an interactive suicidal episode. What's not to love? Anyway, the island is really well done and it makes you feel like you're stuck in a bit of rock in the North Atlantic. And I definitely don't have any bias towards this as an English person who fled England to go live in a remote part of Scotland. Doesn't relate to me whatsoever. You're just putting meaning onto things that aren't there, okay?
You sound like you're from London. Yeah, I'm from London.
Look, even though it is still a cultural juggernaut these days, pun intended, but back in the years between 2007 and 2012, Call of Duty was the biggest thing in the goddamn world. And even me, Mr. Strategy and slow-paced games, spent more than his fair share of time swearing at children on Xbox Live and following on from its controversial scene in Modern Warfare 2 where you gun down at airport civilians. This time in Modern Warfare 3, you get to experience the wonder of a chemical terror attack from the perspective of a tourist family. It also has a bit where you chase down a tube train down a tunnel, which totally got ripped off for that bit in Skyfall. There was a multiplayer level set in a tube station where you could vent all of those fantasies of stabbing a guy who stuck his BO-riddled armpit square into your face during rush hour.
Prince's Vaultman, can you imagine it? Are they rarities?
Oh fuck, I better go and speak to my boring wife.
I never fucked with the Uncharted games. When the first one came out, I read it as a knockoff Tomb Raider or Indiana Jones game and I swerved it, to be frank. I also didn't have a PS3, because who did when they first came out? But then suddenly, there was like four games, and some spin-off games, and even a terrible movie with Marky Mark Wahlberg. Uncharted 3, though, featured a couple of levels set in, you guessed it, a London pub and a section of the underground. Is this all you think we are, America? Just a series of tubes and drinking holes in the only city in the country? I mean, for fuck's sake, we don't assume everything is in New York. Just, you know, most of it.
Don't say that. That.
What?
That. The Z word. Don't say it.
Why not?
Because it's ridiculous.
We have wanted a UK-set zombie game since 28 Days Later came out, frankly. And even more so when other UK-based zombie films were popping off in the 2000s, like Shaun of the Dead and Pontypool. All we wanted was a kind of Dead Rising with traffic wardens. However, Zombie is a bad game. It originally was a Wii U exclusive game, and it had a nice little novelty to it, where when you wanted to look inside your inventory, you had to physically look on the touchpad of the Wii U controller, and you wouldn't be able to look at the screen. You would be more vulnerable from zombie attacks, and you wouldn't be able to see what's around you because you're focusing on your bag. That was a really cool idea, something that messes with the kind of conventionality of video game controllers and playstyles. They fucked all that into the bin for the ports to other consoles. It just became a generic bad Dead Island knockoff set in the UK. If you've ever had the urge to play a game that feels like the outside bits from Shaun of the Dead, this is worth a go. But if not, I'll skip this stinker.
Now you must reactivate the primary drive in engineering.
You want me to go crawling through the ducts again?
I enjoy the sight of humans on their knees. That is a joke.
Right.
Mass Effect 3. Everyone's favourite divisive ending game. It's Mass Effect 3. Although I can and will at some point argue that this is actually the best Mass Effect game. The inclusion of the UK doesn't really push any comfort zones. We once again have a future, ruined version of London to visit, and the moment of peace before the final push against the Reapers is good. It gives you a moment to say goodbye to all the characters, and it gives you a nice setting, a war-torn, broken London to do it in. I mean, admit that all the building style is the Mass Effect Sid Mead-style futurism, but you get the occasional double yellow line on the road or a red phone box, you know? They tried, at least. We get some British characters with Dick Van Dyke accents, but still, for what is only one of a couple of brief glimpses of what Earth is like in Mass Effect 3, or Earth isn't like in Mass Effect circa 2183, if you want to get technical about it, I think it does a decent job. Wolfenstein, the New Order. When they rebooted Wolfenstein in 2014, not many of us expected it to be good, and even fewer that played the very mid-2009 reboot did. But admittedly, they managed to knock it out of the park with a post-World War II alternate future set game where Nazis have taken over the world, or at least Europe. Midway through the first game, BJ gets sent to London to steal top secret research from a Nazi base. London is, well, it doesn't look like London anymore. It's been completely rebuilt in a version of Albert Speer's Germania. Lots of classical looking buildings, domes and pillars built out of harsh concrete to inhuman scale. They attempted to start rebuilding Berlin in this style in real life, but then it turned out to be horrendously inefficient and flawed. Unsurprising, given the Nazis' history. Anyway, in the game it works well in showing how much the Nazis have beaten down the English state and how they have completely rewritten the landscape of the country that they have occupied. It shows the power and the range of the Nazis in the fucking game. Yeah.
I mean, trees! Everywhere trees! What the hell is this place? All right, I'm hitching a ride back home.
Another walking sim game, another game by the Chinese Room, and another game set in the UK. This one is Everybody Has Gone to the Rapture, a tiny little sci-fi mystery game set in a couple of tiny villages and the surrounding countryside in Shropshire, which, for those that aren't aware, is kind of the bit of England between the Midlands and Wales. Not quite Wrexham bad, but bit south of there. It does, however, perfectly capture the vibes of remote and rural England. It's set in the 1980s, and the mix of small village details, the old cards on the street, and the bits of graffiti gave me actual powerful flashbacks to being a kid. I won't go into story spoilers, because I do advise people to try this game if you can, and lose yourself in it for a couple of hours wandering around a nice little quiet part of England. Genuinely more enjoyable than my returns to England as an adult from Scotland, anyway. The Order. didn't play this turd of a game when it came out in 2015, I'm going to be honest, despite it being one of the few exclusives for the PS4 around that time it launched. It was set in a kind of steampunk Victorian London, where you fight vampires and werewolves and all these kind of paranormal creatures. You can't see this because this is an audio recording, but I'm currently making a jerking off motion as I say this sentence, so that gives you a kind of idea of how much I respect the Order 1886. Get out. Just get out. Despite being a huge Assassin's Creed guy, or Ass Creed guy as we like to be known, and genuinely screaming at them to make a Victorian London set game in the franchise since, I don't know, Assassin's Creed 3, it may come as some surprise to you then that I didn't play Syndicate until 2022. I was one of the many people that got burnt out by the yearly release schedule for these games, and I kind of stepped off the franchise around Black Flag and Rogue, because once they give you a pirate ship, it's hard to top that. Anyway, recently I discovered that all of the Assassin's Creed games were available on PlayStation Plus, and I actually caught myself up on them. All except Unity, because... Anyway, that's a lot of words to say that I really enjoyed Assassin's Creed Syndicate's take on London. It manages to get all the big landmarks that are within central London, and although the map only really stretches from Westminster to the city, a lot of streets don't feel like modern day London, but that's mainly due to the 150 years of, bombing campaigns and redevelopment and just change that London has had. But they have some really nice details in there. The small details that make you go, holy shit, no, I've seen that in real life. That bit of corner work, that bit of architectural design, you can spot it in it. It's fantastic. And jumping across townhouse roofs like a murderous chimney sweep, what's not to love? Oh, Mankind Divided. The game everybody avoided like hell because of Square Enix's absolute dog shit handling of the franchise, with them stuffing it full of microtransactions and basically neutering the game in the hopes of spreading out the money earning with an extra sequel. It's a shame because what there is in the game is an incredible bit of work and worthy of being the sequel to Human Revolution. You spend the majority of the game in a small but dense city map in the Czech Republic, and they do a good job making it feel real and lived in and all the things you want when exploring somewhere in an immersive sim. The ending, however, follows the Mass Effect 3 method of dumping you in London for their big finale at a futuristic expedition centre somewhere on the Thames. Again, you don't really see what it's like to be in London in 2029, as you're limited to backstage areas and corporate meeting rooms. It's a bit weird that this is the second game now to randomly just go to London for the finale, but I can't see a pattern emerging here. So we're going to start to get into the Dave hasn't played these games because he's a PlayStation scrub section. Although, to be fair, this one was on PS4, I just didn't fancy playing it. I just slept on it, presumably because I took one look at the art style and thought, pass. But We Happy Few is a survival horror game set in an alternate 1960s UK. You play a person who lives on a small island off the mainland UK and live in a society that enforces happiness on the population with drugs. Those who refuse to take the zombifying drugs are hunted down as interlopers. Apparently, it takes a lot from films like Brazil in 1984 and the pinnacle of cinema, Equilibrium. From what I saw of the gameplay, it looks like kinda like legendary Slav Junk survival game Pathologic, but obviously toned down and nowhere near as good. But yeah, I never got round to playing this one myself, kinda due to the same issue that ruined Watch Dogs Legions. So stick a pin in that. I hope you've got some pins. Have you got pins? Good. And we'll return to it. I love me some open world semi-realistic racing games, and you would think that I would be all over the Forza Horizon series like a hot flush. But unfortunately, as a series that has thrived since the Xbox One days, I've not had the chance to get into them, which is a shame as Forza Horizon 4 seems laser targeted to be my kind of thing. about when I stopped giving a shit about modern cars because they turned into the bland wind tunnel designed egg looking shit boxes we have these days. So imagine my excitement when they announced that Forza Horizon 4 was going to be set in the UK, and more specifically, the north of England and the south of Scotland. Fuck yes, I thought. I can tear up some desolate Cumbrian roads and then do drag races on the M8. It almost had me ready to pop down the eddies and get an Xbox One. And then the game came out and the map was revealed, and well, the only really Scottish bit in it is Edinburgh, which... Tangent time! Time for tangents! Okay, so I know why they picked Edinburgh over Glasgow, as it's got the aesthetic shit with the Harry Potter streets and the Royal Mile and the castle and all that wank, but according to actual Scottish drivers I know, it's an absolute fucking nightmare to drive in. One-way streets and grid systems and busted up tram lines to navigate. Glasgow is clearly the far superior city to be setting a driving game in. Like, you have the grid, like Edinburgh in the central, but surrounding that is the M8 in the very motorways that would be great for, I don't know, a fucking racing game. And then after that, you've got a lot of hills and winding streets. You've got variation in the roads. The fact that the city was completely excised from Forza Horizon 4 and it just doesn't exist in that world is frankly fucking unacceptable. And in my anyway, despite my own personal issues, the general consensus on Horizon 4 that it was good. And in some ways, not topped by Horizon 5's Mexico setting and slide towards microtransaction grave. I look forward to getting around to Horizon 4 at some point, although I do lament the fact that I can't recreate Fast and the Furious in George Square. Real talk, right? So I fell out of the Pokemon loop with Gen 3, and although I've played several games since and have had a healthy hobby reading lore and information about Pokemon, I never really sunk into the games like I did when I was a wee boy. Although there has been some Gen 2 ROM hacks that give me that feeling back to me. In 2019, they released Pokemon Sword and Shield, set in a UK analogue, Galar region, and it was only a matter of time before we got our representation in the Pokemon universe, with them running out of Japanese locations to emulate in Gen 4, leading to New York, the New York Pokemon, the France Pokemon, and the Hawaiian Pokemon. The Galar region is basically a flipped upside down United Kingdom, which means that the starter village, Postwick, is set in their version of Cumbria. You've got Manchester analog Motostoke, which is all red brick and Industrial Revolution looking buildings. You've got Holbury, which is meant to be Liverpool. Turffield, where all the transphobes live. And Windon, which is so obviously London that the name feels kind of like a real 5pm on a Friday sort of situation. The DLC takes you to places inspired by the Isle of Man and the mysterious ancient frozen wastes of... Scotchland? Anyway, my Pokenut friends claim this is a good one. So if you want the experience of living in the UK with only slightly increased amounts of dogfighting, then Sword and Shield isn't the worst option to take. Wait, haven't we done this one already? They made a remake of this fucking game? Wait,
A remake or a remaster?
Because there are some very serious people at Digital Foundry and who insist on there being a... Modern Warfare 2019 is a cool, gritty reboot of a cool, gritty reboot of a Call of Duty franchise in Call of Duty 4, Modern Warfare. That was a game that came out before most Zoomers, however, so they had to reboot it to sell battle passes to kids. I never bothered with this one. Because why would I pay 65 quid to get called slurs in multiplayer when I can get that experience for free every time I load up GTA Online? From what I know, however, they tried to make this a more modern, more grounded story. There's a couple of missions where you play in old London town, including one which has a shootout at Piccadilly Circus, and another one where you have a no-knock raid on some terrorists living in a terrorist house in London. I will admit the Piccadilly Circus level looks very well done, but I have very little wish to play some dude breaking into a house and shooting the first brown people I see, if I'm brutally honest. Also, the required download with Warzone was frankly obscene. I have a base PS4. I ain't got that kind of memory space, alright? It is, how video game Donkey put it best, Metal Gear Duck. The game is a unique ride where you play as the most abusive goose there can be, otherwise known as any goose. It's set in a kind of idyllic English village that has the same vibes as the sort of village you see in children's cartoons, your Fireman Sams, your Postman Pats. So there is a kind of variety of archetypes that you can horrendously bully as a goose, from the bespeckled nerdy child to the angry rake-owning farmer. Great game, would honk again. I love a good rally game, having grown up in the glory days of Sega Rally and the like, so when I got the option to try Dirt Rally 2.0, I jumped at the chance, because it was free. Sadly, in the base game, you find a real lack of any UK-based courses. You get Silverstone as a rallycross stage, and that's basically it. But if you decide to slap down some buckaroos for the DLC, you can rally in such exciting locales as Perth in Kinross in Scotland, or Powys in Wales. I will say that they have managed to effectively capture the gloom and drizzle of those places beautifully.
You do know Londoners have died before, The plague, the great fire, the blitz.
And we hit another one of the games that actually made me want to make this list, 2020's Watch Dogs Legion. When the game first came out, I was one of three people that thought it was okay. The first one, that is. I mean, Aiden Pierce is an actual bellend, but the world map of Chicago and the hacking and sneaking were competent enough, and it gave me the smallest glimpse, the tiniest crumbs into what a modern day Assassin's Creed would look like and play like, since Ubisoft seemed terrified of ever actually making that an actual game. I've heard good things about the sequel as well, but the Nathan Barley style hacktivism advertising in the main plot of Watch Dogs 2 frankly put me off. So I don't want to play some young gonks trying to change the world and get clout for it, so I skipped that one. Then they announced Legion, and for a brief moment I got fucking excited. But unfortunately, and this is probably just my weirdo opinion again, but they fucked it with the setting. They really just shit the bed. You see, Legion isn't set in modern day London, it does the dystopian set a few years from the modern day kind of thing, right? It's set in an authoritarian police state version of London, with drones and self-driving cars and general cyberpunk sheen all over the city. My counterpoint to this is that modern day London is already an authoritarian police state cyberpunk dystopia, and it doesn't need the extra layer of parody bullshit over it. The other selling feature was the ability to play as anyone. You could build a resistance out of a multi-cast of businessmen, mothers, builders, roadmen, and grannies, that sort of thing, you know? But the problem with that mechanic is that naturally, some characters just have better stats and skills than the novelty ones. Why would you play as a granny when you can play as a spy who has stat buffs? Exactly. Good game. Bad idea. Oh, Valhalla. This is the game that everyone and their brother said was too long, too full of bloated content even by the Ubisoft Collectathon standards. I had a 3-week window to play this game before it was removed from Forks Game Pass, and I think I got about 15% in. And I'm a man with very few social obligations. People don't call me, people don't visit me, they leave me the fuck alone. And I wasn't able to scratch the surface of this game. And the main complaint everyone says about Assassin's Creed Valhalla is it's too fucking big. And, sir, this sandwich is too big. Anyway, it starts in a reasonably large version of Norway before you get exiled to the strange and unknown lands of Angleland. The story descended into petty fiefdom rivalries, and I didn't manage to get through the entire England arc. And I'm told that after the England arc is even more story set in Vinland and several realms of the Norse mythology. But I did do what I normally do when given a big Ubisoft map buffet, and I spent about 3 days floating around the map, discovering viewpoints and collectibles, and generally seeing what Dark Ages England had to offer. The map itself is quite substantial. It stretches from southern England to about Cumbria, and covers most of England west of the English-Welsh border. So unfortunately, or unfortunately, they don't have my core... So unfortunately, or unfortunately, they don't have my cursed former home county of Somerset in there. Although, if you go down a Viking raid on the River X, which is way down towards Devon and Cornwall. It was interesting seeing England in a time frame that is normally skipped or brushed over in TV, I'll be honest. With the pre-United Kingdoms all scrapping to try and be top dog whilst competing with an invasion from the Vikings. London is in there, a former Roman town now mostly made of ruins, haunted by a constant fog. It does a pretty good job of giving you the impression of what it was like to live in the ruins of what used to be the reach of Imperial Rome. If you can decipher the old English names for the towns, you'll discover that York, Gloucester, Winchester, as well as smaller, less known places like Ely, a particularly windswept part of the Norfolk Fens, are included in the game. All in all, an impressive attempt, but then again, Assassin's Creed, whilst not the most historically accurate in its plots and characters, does tend to have very decent skill when it comes to creating their open worlds. I feel sorry for the incredibly talented team of world makers that are forced to work in the IP mines for Microsoft, as, like my old video on the crew, there are amazing world spaces that kind of get slept on because they're shoved into the 20th Assassin's Creed game. I've talked for way too long, and you get the point. There's been a bunch of games set in the UK, and it's been a real mixed bag. Of course, as soon as I release this, they will probably announce another big UK set video game and make this whole video out of date. But until then, or the next video, or whatever, I hope you enjoyed my weird, eclectic look at some of video games through a English, if not British, lens. Next video is going to be about Farscape and how incredibly horny that show was, so stay tuned for that in the next 3 to 5 years. Until next time, stay sexy, motherfuckers, and remember, don't play the Order 1886, it's so bad! Why would you play that?